Tonight we have a very distinguished guest, Dr. Anthony Fiorillo. He has done something I've never done and never will do. For 22 years, he has traveled to Alaska and sometimes gone in by helicopter and then navigated on river rafts and then literally scaled vertical cliffs to do his research. I'm pleased to and honored to introduce Dr. Anthony Fiorillo.
Thank you, Tom, and thank you to the Allen Public Library for this opportunity to talk about something that is something very near and dear to my heart. I love this stuff, and I certainly appreciate the opportunity to talk to people. As I listened to you do your introduction, and we had spoken earlier about some of the background. I'm struck by connections between people and ideas and so on. And I know some people might think about a guy in Dallas doing work up in Alaska. That seems very disconnected. But I think if I understood the email I got today correctly, that I am actually also associated with the University of Alaska campus, the geology department, and I work with students there. And there is a student in the geology department who part of her family is in the Dallas area. And as I understand it, some of her nieces and nephews are tuned in tonight for this talk. And Tom, her Aunt Marie apparently is good friends with you. And Marley's last name is Harrelson, if that means anything to you. So again, we are all connected in one way, shape, or form, even though geographically we're very far away with our talk subject matter tonight. I'm going to share my screen now. And we can get the talk moving. So I am Dr. Anthony Fiorillo. I'm at Southern Methodist University. And if you are on Twitter, I'm pretty active on Twitter. There's my handle. You can follow some of the updates on the work, which is continuing, on if you're curious to see what's new. So this is we're going to the far north. We are going to Arctic Alaska for the next 20 or 30 minutes. This is a perfectly good summer day. This photo was taken in late July or early August. I don't remember now. And this is one of our camps. And so before we get too far along, one of the misperceptions about the Arctic is that, yes, we will occasionally see a polar bear, but no, we don't actually see penguins. And there were a number of people who, when I first started this project, asked if we saw penguins. And I thought this cartoon said it best. They are polar opposites. And unless I'm at a zoo in Anchorage, I won't see a penguin over the course of my work. But I am a paleontologist. I'm a paleontologist by training. I'm a paleontologist through the course of my career. Moms, dads, there is a music video by a group called They Might Be Giants. I am a paleontologist. And if you don't know it, your kids might, but it's well worth the look. It's a terrific music video. And here are some of the things that we have dug up over the course of time at the Perot Museum that are on display. Much of my career was spent at the Perot. But when we're going to Alaska, and one of the things that I'd like to get across is most people, their perception of Alaska is looking at a map and it would look something like this. Here's the lower 48, here's Texas, and tucked in the corner is Hawaii and Alaska. And so if you haven't been to Alaska, you could possibly think of Alaska as almost the size of Hawaii. But in fact, this is to scale. Alaska represents 20% of the geography of the United States. It goes from coast to coast and border to border. And so getting around in a state like this presents certain challenges. It is, in fact, so huge that you can walk the streets of Anchorage and find a tourist shop that would sell you this t-shirt, because Alaska is 2.5 times the size of Texas. And when I first started working here about 22 years ago, this is an old map, but in terms of dinosaur paleontology, the word to focus on here is unexplored, unexplored. It's throughout this map. And really, Alaska was a vast territory that we knew almost nothing about in terms of dinosaurs. And I found that an interesting challenge to undertake. So when we go out hunting, there's a vast area looking for dinosaurs. How do we do that? Well, there's a lot of things that we do, but some people might consider it a little bit of divine intervention that plays a role, and maybe it does, maybe it doesn't, but I know that I actually start my projects with library research, and that seemed an appropriate thing to bring up given that the Allen Public Library is hosting this talk. I came across this sign, dinosaurs didn't read, now they're extinct, coincidence. Read, read, read. That is what we do before we ever set foot in the field, because it's kind of got one chance and you want to do all the background work you can to prepare. Once you decide where you're going, how do you get there? You do a lot of hiking, or do you fly there? And this is a little plane. I'm in an identical plane taking this picture. Do you boat there? This is the Yukon River, where we were able to use a motorized boat as opposed to a raft. And then you set up camp. This is the same camp one day and then a few days later when a snowstorm came through. So you have to like camping. You have to like being outdoors, and you also have to like to put up with a lot of other things. I don't know how well you can see this, but all these little things are mosquitoes on a particularly bad mosquito-y day. These are actual field notes that I took, and it's not that I closed the book like this to try to trap mosquitoes, but whenever I wrote something, closed the book, I opened the book and found a few more squashed mosquitoes. So you have to have a pretty high tolerance for inconveniences. Another thing I'd like to have to bring you up to speed on a little bit is a lot of the pictures I'll show you, I'm carrying a pack like this. It's something you don't really leave, you don't leave home without it. So I'm gonna go through what it is that we're carrying on our backs. This is a sense of the clothes that you throw in that pack. You take extra layers because the weather is going to change from when you leave camp to when you get back. And so you try to be as prepared as you can for everything. These are waterproof bags that you keep your dry clothes in. And you have sets of gloves, different kinds of hats, and so on. Another thing that's in that pack is your collecting gear. These are regular Ziploc bags. Leatherman, a multi-use tool, a rock hammer, that field notebook I just showed you a picture of, a number of pens and pencils, a compass, measuring tape, magnifying glass. The toilet paper is for, these are plaster bandages that you put around bones that you find, and you don't want the plaster to stick to bones, so you use toilet paper as a separator. These are silicone molding compounds in case you find something like a footprint that you want to take a mold of. And then, of course, there's other recording gear. A water bottle. Yes, I am a Yankee fan, so don't hold that against me. A water pump, because water is heavy, so you try not to carry more than a water bottle full, and then find a creek where you can pump more. Sunglasses. Cameras, we usually take a couple of cameras for different purposes, and sunblock. And then there is communication gear that you have to carry. This is a satellite phone with some backup batteries and a waterproof case. You use the phone to communicate with other members of your team who might be somewhere else out on the river or on the mountain. And you also use that for coordinating when an aircraft is going to come and pick you up. And because it's very possible to come across neighbors like this, and I or one of my field crew took every one of these pictures, so these aren't internet grabs. You also have to carry things to keep bears away from you. So you usually try to see the bear before it sees you. So you have binoculars. This is a marine flare. There's a pepper spray. There's a whistle. This is a trash bag because you can take a trash bag out and snap it in the wind, and that will startle it, startle a bear. And then a last resort bear deterrent is, I think you know what that is. And so that's what's generally in the pack or in my hands in any of the pictures that you see. Now, dinosaurs lived from about 250 million years ago to about 65 million years ago. They lived in a time called the Triassic, the Jurassic, and the Cretaceous. Everything that we're going to talk about is from the Cretaceous. The rocks that we live on in the Dallas-Fort Worth area are about this age, somewhere around 100 million to maybe 65 million years old. So what about the Alaska dinosaurs? That's what we're supposed to be talking about. Where we're going, here's the outline of Alaska, is way up here. This is the Brooks Range. The Arctic Circle is right around here. And we're going to about where that rectangle represents. This is the Colville River. It is the biggest river on the North Slope in Arctic Alaska. And we're going to go visit these bluffs. The brown is Pleistocene, and that in those brown deposits you might find mammoths or a variety of ice age things, but the gray are rocks that are about 70 million years old, and that's what we're going to talk about. Here are those bluffs again. They go on for miles and miles, and here's how we go to work on these in these inflatable boats. And we have had good fortune to find and collect literally thousands upon thousands of pounds of bones. The last time I tallied the toll was about 13,000 pounds of dinosaur bones came from Arctic Alaska to Dallas. And here you're looking at an upper arm bone, an upper thigh bone. This is a shin bone and a few ribs and things like that of a duckbill dinosaur. And many of the bones, because you're working the bluff, sometimes the bones are down at the bottom where you can just pull the boat up. And sometimes you have to climb a 300-foot bluff to go work on a quarry. And that's what's going on here. How do you get bones off the top of a 300-foot quarry in the middle of nowhere? You use a helicopter. And this site is actually produced about 1,000 bones of a horned dinosaur, close cousin of Triceratops, called Pachyrhinosaurus. This is a skeleton on display, and there's an actual skull of Pachyrhinosaurus, and this is a reconstructed cast. Another dinosaur from these bluffs is a pygmy tyrannosaur named Nanoxaurus, which literally means polar bear lizard. And the Pachyrhinosaurus and the Nanoxaurus are two dinosaurs that had not been known before. But based on this work, I had the good fortune of being able to name both of those dinosaurs with a good colleague of mine. And so that was pretty fun. Another meat-eating dinosaur is Troodon, famous for very large eyes in relation to body size. It's essentially the owl of the dinosaur world. Those predatory dinosaurs, in addition to Pachyrhinosaurus, were also likely eating these duckbill dinosaurs. And here's a team excavating duckbill dinosaur bones along the Colville River. Dinosaur's name is Edmontosaurus. Now, one dinosaur can make a lot of footprints. And really, if I were to say, what do we find more of? It is footprints. And so we're going to Denali National Park, home of the tallest mountain in North America, Denali. And here's our ride. And Denali is now located down here. We were just up here. And here's the most spectacular footprint site we found. It looks like it's several layers of dinosaur footprints, when in fact, what it is I'll show you in a moment, one bedding plane, and every one of these dimples represents a dinosaur footprint. There are literally thousands upon thousands of dinosaur footprints on this bedding surface. We went in there and mapped, and there's this wonderful exhibit at the Perot Museum, which shows details of this track site. Here's a mold that we made on the track site, which produced one of these casts that you can interact with. This site, when we first found it, looked like it had five levels to it, but we found it on the last day of the field season. The helicopter came to pick us up, and it was very nasty wind conditions. So we didn't understand how you get five layers overlaying each other the way it was. And the helicopter pilot, because it was so windy, didn't want to hover so we could look down on the site from the air. He just wanted to get us out of there. Well, as it turned out, what we discovered the next season we got in there is it was one layer, and it's faulting and sliding down the mountain. And so because of that, the Park Service let us do a lot of detailed work they would not normally let us anyone do in a wilderness area. So that's why we were able to get in with helicopter support the following year. The sum total of 22 years of work is that there's an incredible diversity of dinosaurs from the Alaskan Arctic. Nanoxaurus, Pachyrhinosaurus, Edmontosaurus. You can actually see this mural in the visitor center at Denali National Park if you ever go up there for a visit. We have duck-billed dinosaurs, flying reptiles, pterosaurs, birds, and even small mammals. And then this weird dinosaur called a therizinosaur, which is a plant-eating, meat-eating dinosaur. It started as a meat-eater and gave up meat and started to eat plants. It looks like something right out of your nightmares. So that being the case, dinosaurs have been up there. There's a diverse fauna. What were they doing? And a big question that has been asked, and we've asked it, is did Arctic dinosaurs migrate much like you would see caribou herds, or did they live in the Arctic all year round? And really, this is what sparked the invitation to talk to you this evening, because recently, those 13,000 pounds of bones are still being worked on at the museum, and new discoveries are happening all the time. And one of those new discoveries came from this bluff, a windswept bluff, and there's a person for scale, and he is, in fact, the other person that's working with our student in Fairbanks who has family here in Allen. Last year, we found a brand new mammal, which we nicknamed Night Mouse. It's an Inupiat word, Unawakmees. But looking at the site in more detail, we discovered we actually had a baby dinosaur jaw. And this dinosaur jaw belongs to a baby meat-eating dinosaur, Dromaeosaur. It's got a sickle toe, and it's famous from the Jurassic Park movies. But while Dromaeosaur, named Saurornithelestes, might have been 6 to 8 feet long, this baby was about cat-sized. Big cat, but cat-sized. And so it was much too small to have migrated. So we have evidence for the very first time that says at least some dinosaurs nested in the Arctic, which for us opens up a bunch of exciting questions about how did they adapt? What did they do? In many ways, Alaskan dinosaurs challenge every single thing we think we know about dinosaurs, which is why this has been so much fun. So we will continue to go back, and hopefully at the end of the rainbow, we will continue to find new and cool things to talk about. This is a team SMU has been very supportive. One of our funders is the Explorers Club in New York. This is a team from a field season a couple of years ago. We work extensively with some Japanese. And hopefully this work will help inspire the next generation of paleontologists. This is the New York World's Fair in 1964. This is a small version of the person you're looking at right now. This dinosaur sculpture is now at Dinosaur Valley State Park in Glen Rose. And that's my daughter, who is now 18 years old and off at university. But the point being that hopefully this work will help inspire future generations of curious kids to go explore dinosaurs. And for other people, if you are curious about knowing more about Alaskan dinosaurs, I wrote a book that got published in 2018, Alaska Dinosaurs, an Ancient Arctic World. And there's a website where you can look it up. And with that, I will turn it over to anybody who may have a question or two to ask about the dinosaurs that we've talked about this evening. Thank you.
Tony, the first question is, apparently 17 years ago, 20 years ago, the thinking was that dinosaurs from Alaska migrated to Texas and back to Alaska. Of course, the Rocky Mountains may or may not have existed at the time, but it appears that the thinking now is that they migrated to Asia as opposed to Texas. Can you comment on that?
Sure, and you're absolutely right. When we spoke years ago, there was some thought about dinosaur migration. The dinosaurs migrated between places like West Texas on up to Alaska. And that has sort of moved by the wayside. You noticed in one of those pictures, I'm working with several Japanese. And the reason for that, well, one of the oldest one in that picture is a former SMU student that I worked with. And we've maintained a relationship. And as a result, it's allowed us to compare Asian dinosaurs and Alaskan dinosaurs and some Canadian dinosaurs. And we're starting to see that these linkages go between Asia and Northern North America rather than North-South.
What kind of education is required to become a paleontologist?
Well, the beauty of... Well, answer that question by telling you about my background is that I have 3 degrees. I have a bachelor's degree, a master's degree, and a PhD. They all came from geology departments. They all, as each degree progressed, they became more specialized in dinosaur paleontology. And so that's the route I took. And many of my colleagues have taken a similar path. Some come through biology departments, some have come through anthropology departments. But the beauty of paleontology is that you can have a highly educated background, formal educated background like I do, but contributions, important contributions to the field can be made by anybody who's curious and keeps their eyes open. I have lost count of the number of important discoveries that have been made by what we call them amateurs, and they range in age from school-aged kids to adults that just go out and explore the creeks and lakes around us on the weekends and keep their eyes open. So I like the profession because of this nice balance between anybody, the formally educated as well as the curious. Anybody can contribute.
When DFW Airport was being constructed in the early 70s, a number of dinosaurs were discovered during the excavation process. Could you comment on that?
Sure. When DFW, the dinosaur in particular that seems to have been the first one to make a splash, was something that a former SMU student studied, and it's called Protohadros. And it was considered to be one of the most primitive duck-billed dinosaurs known at the time. And it was originally described from skull material, but as more work has been done on what we call the Woodbine Formation, which is a rock that shows up around Lake Grapevine, for example, there are more and more parts of the skeleton that are becoming known because other parts have been found. So we're starting to get a pretty good idea of what Protohadros looked like.
Can you describe the geologic? This is, of course, would take hours to answer, but could you briefly describe the geologic history of the Dallas-Fort Worth area?
Well, basically, the area that we live in, depending on where you are as you drive the highways, there are a number of, it's all Cretaceous through where we are until you get farther east, but we'll stay within the Metroplex. And the rocks tend to be rocks laid down under a shallow ocean. And then there's times where the seaway shrank, and then you have terrestrial rocks that are laid down by rivers and floodplains. And so that's why you can find some dinosaur footprints in our areas, because sometimes that sea retreated. But for the most part, the sea was here. And by a shallow sea, it's not something that we would have been able to wade across. But a lot of the tall buildings, if that sea were in place now, a lot of the tall buildings in Dallas would stick up above the water level.
Can you comment on some of the dinosaur discoveries in the Metroplex as I recall, there was a rim at one of the times in geologic history that kind of it began around the Glen Rose area all the way to through the northern DFW area that was on the edge of the ocean. Was this pretty much the case throughout the Metroplex?
Again, it sort of depends on where you are in the Metroplex, and the sea was never exactly the same year to year to year. You know, it kind of ebbed and flowed depending on what else was going on in the world that controlled sea level. So yes, you are right. There are dinosaur footprints. Glen Rose is a spectacular example of being at the edge of a seaway and all these dinosaur footprints were there. If you think back about, and I've been to Glen Rose more times than I can count, but about 10 years ago, I think it was, we had a particularly strong drought and the Paluxy River had nearly dried up. You go to Dinosaur Valley State Park and where was it? But the upside to that was I was completely blown away by the thousands and thousands of dinosaur footprints that are found there. But that band does come up through the Metroplex, tends to be on the western side, and you can get up to Denton, for example. And there's a dinosaur skeleton that was found there, Tenontosaurus, a smallish plant-eating dinosaur. So that edge of the seaway does continue on up into our area.
Well, thank you so much for your time this evening. And can you recommend a few books besides your own that might give a little bit of enlightenment to the dinosaurs of Texas?
Well, obviously my book is about dinosaurs of Alaska, but my good friend, Dr. Lewis Jacobs, has done a couple of nice pieces that you can probably find at this point, either online or at Half Price Books. One he did on called Cretaceous Airport, which specifically addressed the excavation of protohadros. And then Lone Star Dinosaurs, it's a little out of date by now, but it's still the single best overview of Texas dinosaurs.
Thank you so much, Dr. Anthony Fiorillo.